What's going on, everybody? Today we're going to be doing the valve lash job on this 2007 Yamaha FZ6. This is a substantial job to do because there's a lot of parts to take off. Yamaha recommends you do this every 40,000 kilometers. I've actually done this job before when my bike was at 32,000 kilometers because I had the engine out at the time, so I just thought I might as well do it. So I'm gonna walk you through how we do it with the engine in the bike, and let me tell you, basically everything's coming off. The tank, your intake box, your throttle bodies, your radiator, your valve cover, of course, and your ignition coils and your spark plug leads, all of that's coming off so that you can get to the intake and exhaust cam easily. It's a pretty complicated job, but I'm sure I can walk you through it so that you can feel confident doing it home. I'm following a service manual here, so I have as precise and accurate as information as possible for you watching at home. So please smash the like and subscribe button for this video. This one is a horrendous of a job. I don't need to do it. I'm doing it for you guys. So please smash the like and subscribe button. It would really mean a lot to me. I'm gonna drop all the torque specs in the description down below, and also try and put the important info on the screen as we go. So let's get it. Reading straight from the manual, basically what we got to do is the fuel tank, battery case, air filter, take out the battery box, the throttle bodies, the air cutoff valve. Then you got to do radiator, you got to move your fan out of the way. Ignition coils got to come off the bottom of where they attach. And then it's this valve cover, and this side cover's got to come off. So I'll have all the tool sizes down in the description, but check out my other videos for details on how to take off the fuel tank, radiator, and air filter. While I was taking off the battery box here with the ignition coils on the back, I realized even though the primary side is off and disconnected here and down there, the leads are still going down to the ignition, like to the spark plugs. So I'm gonna leave this in, and hopefully I can leave these leads attached to the coils and just take them out with like the rubber dam that they go through down there all in one piece, because I really don't wanna undo these leads in case I get them mixed up. So one less thing to label if you don't take them apart. So I'm gonna leave that for later. This is one of the hardest joints to get to on this bike, which is the 3mm Allen head that holds the throttle body to the rubber boot that joins it to the cylinder head. You see my Allen key down here? This is the rightmost cylinder. Yamaha designed it so that these can be got, but it's a real pain. See, I've got it. My hand is way down here. It's a pain. You can get it. It takes a lot of fighting. Ugh. Got it loose. You can see it turning. You only need a couple turns. You can see it widening. I rule of thumb, I'd say around 5 turns is good. You don't want to loosen this all the way, or else you're going to slip the bolt out of the hole it's in. So just enough, that's probably good right about there. Now only 3 more to go. This one right here, when you zoom out, that's like right here. You literally have to shove your hand underneath it to get in there. Let's just zoom out a little. This one over here, it's way down here, right where my finger is. You can get it coming towards the camera this angle. All of them can be had, it's just real tricky. Remember, when you do this stuff up, it doesn't have to be doomsday tight, just tight enough to keep this clamp in place and not have a vacuum leak. You can see the leftmost boot here. I've got my Allen key in it right now. This isn't the way you usually get them, as in using like the short end of the Allen key with max leverage. You usually use the long end of the Allen key with minimum leverage, and that's all it should take to tighten them up and loosen them. But on this case, you can get the long end on the leftmost boot. Once you've got the 4 3mm Allen head bolts that hold the throttle bodies down to the cylinder head down there, there's still lots to take off on this setup because the whole rack of ITBs has to come out. So you got to disconnect, obviously, your sensor over here, your TPS down here. You've got a sensor down underneath that green one there that's got to disconnect because the harness clips into the bottom of the throttle body rack. There are throttle cables over here. I was able to get both cables off from the side here. So we got this disconnected. This one's an easy one. You just push down on the tab and pull it out. This one's a little more trick. You have to, where is it? There it is. On this one, you see the tab down. You have to push this tab up. It's not a push down and pull type. Usually you would like grab the female side like over here and just push down and pull, but this is the opposite. You have to flick this tab up while you pull this one out. So it kind of helps to have like a screwdriver in there and lift it up and then pull it out. Be careful, don't pull by the wires, pull by the plastic. I was about to pull off the ITBs after having this and that disconnected, but then I remembered these two lines here are filled with coolant. So I'm gonna drop the radiator and drain the cooling system before I pull these off. I'm gonna take them off this side and let them just hang there next to the motor. Wiggle and pull up moderately hard. They aren't going to gently slide out.
With the throttle bodies off, you can get a great view of what's happening underneath. This is the connection I was fighting with, the last one to get off there. I believe it's your coolant temp sensor. You just gotta thumb it from the bottom and pull it off. I don't know why it was so tricky. These are the 3 mil ones you gotta loosen off. You can see there's a little notch right here that keeps them in place. You don't wanna loosen it off so far that this rotates because it'll just be tricky for you. And you wanna leave them this loose for when you go to put it back together. That way it keeps your Allen head in place. You can push against it and the clamp doesn't spin on the rubber piece. Stepping back a little bit, you can see it's pretty easy down here. It's not a big mess once you're this far in.
As you pull off the side cover, be mindful of the silver timing guide pin. It indexes with the side cover, so be careful to not let it pull out with the cover like I did. The side cover gasket needs to come off to reveal the line on the block that we will be referencing for timing the crank. This is the line in the block that aligns with the T line on the pickup rotor. Use some Scotch-Brite to clear off the gasket residue. Okay, now comes the fun. We've got our crank timing mark aligned with the T, aligned with the line on the block, and the manual specifies that we check cylinder number one for valve clearance first. And that's right, cylinder number one is over here. It is opposite the cam chain. It's riders left on the bike. So one, two, three, four are the cylinders, and the order in which you check them as you rotate over the motor is one, two, four, three. So we're gonna start over here and start getting our feeler gauges out to start shoving them in there to check our clearances. It's pretty tight, but this is why we took off the ITBs to get the intake side a bit easier from up top. Now, this is where the hard part comes in. For this intake cam right here that you can see, the spec is basically between 5 thou and it shouldn't fit in 8 because the spec was 0.0079, which basically means 8 thou won't fly. So when you're testing this, you do need to have a sense of feel for how much friction you're pulling between the cam and the bucket beneath it. A loose fit, basically, you hardly have to force it in. It just slides right in. Like, I'll show you. That's this 5 here. Get this out of the way. When I slide in this 5, it's easy. No drama, nothing, right? Now, I'll show you if you step it up to 6 what it looks like. Now, if we got the 6, it's a little harder. You still got to line it up. Still easy, fits that pretty well. Moving up to the 7, and it's a tighter fit. I can jam it in. If I wiggle and jam, I can get it. It's a little tricky with this angle with the camera in the way, but you get the idea. I can shove it in there and I can see it's just made it under the cam, but I really can't quite get it through. So you know then that it's between 6 and 7, probably closer to the 7 side because the 6 slid right in, which is pretty great. Next, you go to the 8, and even if your 7 fit, if you checked and your 8 didn't fit, you know you're Gucci. And right here, right away, I go to put it in, and the 8 just rams up. It doesn't fit. The 7 feels like if I push it hard enough, I can make it slide in. And that's how you know you've got basically a tight-fitting 7 and a really loose 6. So that tells you the spec is on the high end of 6 and the low end of 7. Now, you might be like, ah, Calvin, this is a bunch of nonsense, but for real, you have to have some amount of feel when putting this in, because you could try and just absolutely ram an 8 in there, but it wouldn't necessarily mean it fits an 8, it just means that you can shove an 8 in there and compress the spring a little bit and force your way to get that extra thousandth of an inch in. But that's not what we're trying to do here. So really, as you go over all 16 valves of this engine, try and gain a feel and an appreciation for how hard you have to push it in when it's lined up right. Now, it can be tricky to get like under the cam caps in here, so keep that in mind. If you're fighting against the wall of something, don't like consider that added friction because of the gap, but consider that kind of rubbing up against something, not having the right angle. But the friction you feel when you put it in is an indicator of how big or tight the gap is. Next up, to measure cylinder number 2, we need to turn the crank, and the manual recommends you turn it 180 degrees. Now the manual says you're supposed to turn this engine counterclockwise, but I'm almost certain that's wrong because the tensioner is on the left side chain here, and you always put the tensioner on the slack side of the belt, which means it would pull down on the crank here, turning this direction and leave slack on the left side going up back to the motor. So even though the manual says counterclockwise, I'm almost certain it is clockwise. So I'm going to continue with that. Also, I've done it that way before, so can't have broken anything yet. Now we're going to turn 180 degrees. Basically, just going to put this T over here. Right there. Real happy. Your next cylinder you're going to get to is cylinder number 4. You're going to turn it another 180 degrees and line it up with this mark again. And then to get to cylinder number 3, you're going to go another 180 degrees back to where it is right now, and that's how you'll measure cylinder number 3. That's a wrap on the FZ6 valve lash inspection. I know this might feel like I'm leaving you guys hanging with not taking out the cams, but all my valve lash is in spec, so I don't have to do it. But I am going to tell you a bit about how you do it. So I'm going to insert some photos over top of this or after this to show you what the manual tells you. You line up your T with the line on the block here, and then you've got two lines. You got a line on the exhaust cam and the intake cam, and they line up with the top half of the cylinder head. And you're looking for cylinder number 1, which is on the rider's left. The cam loves to be pointing away from each other. The cylinder number 1 is on power stroke, basically about to make power at the top of compression at the beginning of power. So the cam lobes will be pointing directly away from each other. That's what you want to be looking for. When I first timed this motor many years ago when I did this job before, I got confused and thought cylinder number 1 was right here. And I was like, why aren't these lobes lining up? This makes no sense. But you got to remember, it's cylinder number 1 over on the back here on the left. Other than that, it's a pretty straightforward job to do. I know you might be wondering about the cam chain tensioner. And I'll talk more about that in the manual in just a sec, but this was quite an undertaking of a job. I really appreciate you guys watching. We're almost at 500 subs at the time of filming this, and I can't be any more thankful for all of you that have joined me for the ride through this FZ6 maintenance stuff. It warms my heart to see so many of you being helped by this content, and I'm just happy to be here doing it for you. So if you could, smash the like and subscribe button, and as always, hope you have a good day. To remove the cams and gain access to the valve spring buckets and the shims, align the engine crank markings to TDC on cylinder 1, then begin by taking out the cam chain tensioner. Loosen the center bolt, then remove the two Allen head bolts holding in the tensioner. With the tensioner removed, loosen the cam cap bolts in a crisscross pattern, working from the outside in to prevent cracking a camshaft by releasing them unevenly. Before pulling a camshaft out of the head, use a wire or a bungee cord to ensure the timing chain does not fall into the crankcase. Before you go any further, stuff rags into the oil drain holes to prevent any shims falling deep down into your engine. Next, use a magnet stick to lift out the buckets that cover the valves and shims. The shim hides underneath the bucket on the tip of the valve. Sometimes the shim comes out with the bucket, sometimes it stays attached to the valve. The shims look like this and have a 3-digit number indicating their thickness in millimeters. 195, like this one here, means the shim is 1.95 millimeters thick. Yamaha rounds the pad value to the nearest 5. Refer to the diagram here to get an idea of how they round the numbers. You can also use a micrometer to measure the shim to get a precise measurement. Remember to keep track of which shim and bucket came from which valve, or else you will have to reassemble the top end to remeasure the clearances. This may sound sketchy, but it worked for me. When I did this job on my bike 30,000 kilometers ago, I had a couple valves with too tight a clearance by 1 or 2 thou. I used fine sandpaper and a flat glass surface to sand off 1 or 2 thou I didn't need. I was able to do this with great precision because I had a micrometer that measured down to 1/10,000th of an inch, so keep that in mind as an option. To reinstall the top end, replace all your shims and buckets on the same valve they came from. All parts must be meticulously cleaned and lubricated with engine oil. Align the crank with the line on the block and lower the cams into their journals in the approximate orientation. The important timing marks are the I line on the intake cam gear and the E line on the exhaust cam gear. These lines should be flush with the top of the cylinder head. Leave as little slack as possible on the section of chain between the exhaust cam gear and the crank gear. You want the tensioner to take up the slack without rotating the crank independently of the cam gears. With the cam caps tightened down to 7.2 foot-pounds in a crisscross fashion, install the tensioner. The tensioner is reset by removing the center cap bolt and inserting a narrow screwdriver to rotate the internals clockwise until the protruding end of the tensioner is fully retracted. You must install the tensioner onto the engine with the screwdriver still holding the tensioner from extending. Once the tensioner is bolted into the head, you can remove the screwdriver and allow the tensioner to extend. This task is easier with a third hand, so borrow a friend if you can. If the tensioner extends before you seat it against the head, you must restart or else the tensioner will apply too much force on the chain. Spin the engine over a couple times, and if the timing marks still align at all three points at the same time, then the motor is timed correctly. If one line is off, you must redo the timing job. The marks on the gears are very precise and leave no question in your mind when they're all lined up correctly. Any slight misalignment should be investigated. This can be a very tricky thing to do, but be patient and you'll get it eventually. Thanks for watching and thanks for subscribing. Drop a comment down below if you have any questions and I'll do my best to answer them. And as always, have a good day.